Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
So thank you, everyone, for being here this afternoon to our panel. And I'm Lavana Lewis. I'm the Associate Dean of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion at the Saul Price School of Public Policy. And before I introduce our panelists, I want everyone to know that there's a bookseller right upstairs, and our panelists have made themselves available to sign your book purchases. Let me quickly introduce our panelists in alphabetical order, again, so that you will know a little bit more about who's up here with me. Christopher Emdin is the Robert A. Naslund Endowed Chair in Curriculum and Teaching and the Professor of Education here at USC. And he also serves as Director of Youth Engagement and Community Partnerships at the USC Race and Equity Center. He is the author of numerous award-winning books, including the New York Times bestseller For White Folks Who Teach in the Hood and the Rest of Y'all, Ratchetdemic, Reimagining Academic Excellence, and STEM, STEAM, Make, Dream. Matthew Manos is the founder and managing director of Very Nice, a design practice that gives half of its work away for free to nonprofit organizations. The clientele includes Apple, the United Nations, Google, and the American Heart Association. Matthew is the author of over 30 books and toolkits on the intersection of creativity, social impact, and strategy. They're the director of the Challenge-Based Learning, director of Challenge-Based Learning, and an assistant professor of design strategy at the USC Iovine and Young Academy, and is currently chair of the LA Mayor Garcetti's Creative Advisory Board. One of these toolkits, Less Bad Designs, will be part of our discussion today. And finally, Pedro Negueta is dean of the USC Rossio School of Education and a distinguished professor of education. He is an elected member of the National Academy of Education. His research focuses on the ways schools are influenced by social and economic conditions and demographic trends locally, regionally, and globally. Pedro's latest book, A Search for Common Ground, Conversations About the Toughest Questions in K-12 Education, co-authored with Rick Hess, won the Association of American Publishers 2022 Prose Award. And in 2022, Pedro ranked third in the nation for influence and impact by Education Week. Please welcome them with a round of appreciation. Thank you, just in case we forget. All right, so I'm going to be the moderator, so that means I'm going to be moderate and try to just kind of set things up and hear from you three. Our panel is centered on transformative learning, and again, the title of our session, Transformative Learning, Innovation, Inclusion, and the Future of Education. Centered on transformative learning, which needs to be viewed across the lifespan, from birth to pre-K, K-12, vocational and higher ed, executive education, at work, and then beyond. Each of you has written extensively on the need for transformation and how we view learning and education. And can we start our conversation with what each of you considers critical to our dialogues on transformation? And I'm going to ask to start with you, Pedro, since your career has included the development of centers specifically focused on transformation. And then, Chris, if you don't mind, you'll be our last speaker on that question. So, Pedro, please.
Thank you, Levon. And good afternoon. So I have, for several years, been arguing that we can't simply reform education, tinkering around the edges, that we need to transform it. We need to create schools that where kids are excited about learning, right? Where they don't have to be force-fed. We need to create schools that inspire kids so they can see how knowledge is used and can be applied to solve problems in the world. And we're far away from that. I think our schools today focus on controlling kids. They encourage conformity in not just behavior but in thought. And given the problems facing the world, that's not going to prepare kids for the 21st century. I don't want to spend too much time, but I think that the experience of learning itself, if you watch children, how many of you are parents? Okay, you watch a child learn to do something new, they do it by learn by doing. They learn by asking questions. They learn by going on YouTube to see it modeled. They don't learn by sitting and listening to someone talk at them. We don't teach kids the way they learn. And if schools were simply to start teaching kids the way they learn, they would be very different places. And we recognize that building a sense of community where kids feel safe and appreciated is critical, because you can't learn if you're afraid of making mistakes. And we need that has to be part of the environment too. So I could say a lot more, but that's enough for now.
Thank you. Matthew.
Yeah, wonderful response. And when we were all prepping together on Zoom, a couple weeks ago, I loved this idea of transformation as opposed to reformation. And one of the things that really stood out to me is, coming from kind of a design strategy background, is that that's a lot of what I'm trying to do with my students in the context of the classroom, where, hey, here's a problem that's being put in front of you, right? This is something that we're very accustomed to in learning in the classroom. I know for me, I struggled a lot in math, and I was handed a lot of problems that were predefined for me. And that was something that just didn't really click for me. And I found that is because I'm coming from this design mindset, this kind of creative mindset, where we're interested more in defining what the problem itself even is, as opposed to jumping straight into that solution. This is something I can talk more about maybe a little bit later as well, but that's really what I'm trying to do with my kids in the classroom, my kids being undergraduates, graduate students as well, teaching them how to reflect deeply on what is the actual problem that's trying to be solved. Should I be the one that's even solving this? Should we even solve this? Who's harmed if we solve this? What do we even mean by solve? You know, all these kinds of questions are really critical to me in my work as a design educator.
Thank you. Christopher.
Yeah, I echo all of both sentiments I heard, and both are really brilliant. And the only thing I would add to that is that we have to be sort of more thoughtful about recognizing the ways that young people are designing learning on their own in non-academic settings. And so school has to do a better job at looking at models from non-traditional spaces where people are engaging with each other, and then borrow ideas from those spaces. So for me, I'll look at barbershops. Be like, what? Like, people will show up to the same barbershop year after year, even with a bad haircut, because there's something the barber's doing to make you keep coming back. So the question becomes, what are they doing, right? There might be music in the backdrop. They might be asking me questions about who I am outside of this space. There's a knowledge. So how do we change teachers then to understand that barbershop banter is a pedagogical strategy? It might be the hairdresser. It might be how kids play double dutch. These things that are seemingly mundane and not connected to academic rigor actually are the frames and models for transformative teaching and learning. One of my favorite areas in the sciences that I love is biomimicry, right? You know, engineers are really smart at saying, wait, we can make Velcro by looking at how certain types of weeds stick to your clothes when you're in the woods. Let's replicate that biological model and make a thing. And I would argue we need to take a biomimicry stance in teaching and learning, right? And go to organic spaces where we interact, and then look at models from there, and then implant those models into spaces where kids are or should be learning. And even like learning, I'm sorry, I get excited. You know, even the notion of learning, right, there's a perception that learning is a process that has a sound and defined destination. And anybody who learns anything knows is, the more I play and tinker with the phenomena, the more questions I ask, if I can't get my questions answered, then I start pursuing things that can help me get the answer better, right? I can go and learn physics because I need to know how to jump double dutch better. And I'll keep looking until I can find a method. And then it just takes a teacher to name that thing as physics, right? You knowing when to jump at one pit, do you know that's a physics problem? And now I can get to content through play. I think those kind of models are necessary for transforming schooling.
Thank you so much. I appreciate all of those responses. Again, as each of you kind of helped us understand why our focus on transformation is so important. I want to set up my next question with a quote from Bell Hooks, and I told the folks that I would get this in some kind of way. Bell Hooks' book, Feminism is for Everybody, Passionate Politics. And the quote is, to be truly visionary, We have to root our imagination in our concrete reality while simultaneously imagining possibilities beyond that reality. And I would like to talk about how you engage this tension in your work and your writing. Our concrete reality or problems with the status quo and the imagination needed to move beyond it. The wording of the question will be slightly different as I want to put the focus on particular elements of each of your work. Matthew, I'm going to ask you to start us off using your Less Bad Design Toolkit to help us understand how we can work through our problems without unintentionally making things work. It's a long question.
Oh, yeah. No.
He's ready to go.
Yeah, I know, because it's right pitch to him. In public policy, we talk about how the fear of unintended consequences may lead us to be more incremental in our thinking about how we address problems. You talk about ethical ideation. Can you share with all of us what this means and how this approach helps us to see the new problems our solutions might generate?
Absolutely. Great question. It is right pitch to me. You know, one of the things that I encounter a lot and see this in sort of two contexts, one in the context of a classroom full of innovative students constantly generating ideas for, you know, startups, for products, for services, whatever that might be, solutions to all kinds of different issues that we might see in the world. Something that happens every single time that we go through a brainstorm session is there is an idea that had unintended consequences to it, right? An idea that's maybe making a problem worse, maybe increasing safety concerns, maybe automating so much that we're displacing people, maybe abandoning stakeholders and not actually speaking to the people who are facing, you know, said problem, right, from various perspectives. And one thing that I've learned, actually, is to let that happen, right? So to let there be this open air, blue sky round of ideation and let those mistakes happen in the safety of the classroom, right? Let the students generate these ideas. And then using this toolkit, which is kind of part of what inspired this, I have a list of 12 principles for bad design. And these are basically 12 of the most common unintended consequences. Things like what I just was sort of rattling off. Also, you know, band-aid solutions, right? Not getting to the core of a problem, et cetera. But I found that the big aha moment was letting them come to that idea that had those unintended consequences. And then having us all reflect on our ideas and say, hey, who might be hurt in this process? Or what new problems might we have just created, right? From there, we kind of have a process of then thinking back on our ideas. How can we mitigate these new problems that are being created? What new problems are we willing to accept? And what are we going to do to offset those new problems as well? So for me, I think that's probably the best way that I can answer that is at first letting this failure happen, so to speak, but creating the space for reflection on the new problems that we will undoubtedly come up with, right? When we're trying to be in a creative, a safe space to be creative, we're bound to make some mistakes.
Thank you, Matthew. Christopher, same theme, tension between concrete reality and imagination. And both of your most recent books have reimagining in the title. Ratchetdemic, Reimagining Academic Excellence, and STEM, STEAM, Make, Dream, Reimagining the Culture of STEM, STEAM Fields. And you really challenge the readers to examine so many of the exclusionary practices in our learning environments that disrupt learning, student self-actualization, and the ability of all of us to reach our full potential. Again, long introduction. But can you share more about how you explain the current reality and invite imagination, starting, please, with what you mean by the terms reimagining, ratchet identity, and ratchetdemic?
Great question. So learning requires first safety. If I don't feel safe to make mistakes, if I don't feel safe enough to express who I am, then I'm concerned the entire time about how I'm being read by everybody in the space. I'll give you a quick example, right? you know, if I come from a home background where we speak a different language than if the net language is accepted in school, or we utilize certain slang that school has says, don't ever do this, or I dress a certain way that folks are going to demonize, when I enter into the learning space, the first thing I'm thinking about is not what someone's teaching me, but rather whether or not I am acceptable to them, right? It's like, I won't ask a question because I don't know if you are going to make fun of my accent. I can't learn. Every time I say something, I'm wondering, did I say it with my bad accent? Or, you know, like if I wear a certain way I show up, for example, this hat, right? The hat's a part of my identity, right, for a couple of reasons. Somebody's like, why does he have his hat on in the building? Why is that necessary? There's a whole political thing for me about why I wear this hat. But if I'm concerned that you might judge me being on a panel with a hat on, the entire time I'm talking, I'm saying, are they still listening? My hat's still on, right? So Ratchetdemic is about recognizing that to teach someone, you've got to withhold your judgment about who they are, and they have to be comfortable enough being safe to be themselves. So to be ratchet, in sort of colloquial discourse, is to express all negative characteristics associated with, I would say, urbanness, right? Like, your ratchet friend doesn't say, yes. Your ratchet friend says, anyone? Hell yeah. Hell yeah. Or yes. They're a little extra, right? And oftentimes, a person who says hell yes or yes, it's like they must not be smart. So then we start making decisions, right? Am I going to be myself or am I going to be smart? Am I going to be myself or am I going to be academic? And there's this internal dialogue going on, and then your brain doesn't have the capacity to learn. So to be ratchetdemic is to enter into a learning space being free enough to be equal parts ratchet and academic. I love y'all. I appreciate that you're here to hear us speak, but I'm going to wear my hat, right? And I'm not going to concern myself about whether or not you'll judge me for wearing my hat because I know something I have to say is important, right? So a ratchetdemic identity is that every single one of us in this space deserves the right to be themselves and can be themselves and reach the height of being academic. And this is the part. If all young people enter into schools feeling as though they're not going to be judged for being who they are, then their mind is not preoccupied with respectability politics, and then they're open to receive what it is you have to teach them. So that's the fundamental premise around being ratchetdemic. But most importantly, I think that's the key to stretching, growing, right? That I'm myself and can learn at the same time. I am ratchetdemic.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that and feel it 100%. Pedro, I know that you did a full panel on your book, but I had one specific question about your book. And you start off, again, Search for Common Ground, Conversations about the Toughest Questions, addressed head-on how our current reality is often about scoring points and trying to prove we are right about what is happening in education. In the book, you use authentic dialogue with the conservative education scholar Rick Hess as a vehicle responding to our reality while also imagining something better. Can you just share the evolution of what that dialogue was like for you, and also, Rick, if you feel comfortable doing so, and what lessons from your dialogue in book form means for the rest of us as we think about how we work through or with those who have opposing views about education, especially given our current polarization and divisiveness?
So I think for those who get a chance to read the book, what it's really about the power and importance of dialogue. You can't have dialogue if you're not listening to each other, right? And responding to what the other person is saying. And that requires trust. It goes back to this point that that Chris was making, is if I think that you're going to use what I say against me, right, then we're not really listening. I'm thinking, how am I going to score points? But if there's enough trust that I think it's going to be an honest conversation, then we can actually explore our differences through a dialogue. And even as though I'm still trying to get him to see things the way I do, but I'm going to try to do it in a way that does not belittle or villainize him in trying to make that point. And that's, I think, what we tried to illustrate. And that's why so many people are interested in the book, because they can't believe that two people who disagree could have a respectful dialogue, which is ironic in this country that we can't do that. And I think that if we can model that for kids, you know, we talk about American history. American history is fraught with so many problems, right? But it's also a history of change. And, you know, you take a figure like Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson owned slaves, fathered children with Sally Hemings, and wrote the Declaration of Independence, and was a great advocate of freedom and democracy. How do we reconcile the two, right? Kids need to interrogate that and see. And as they do, does the fact that he was a slave owner negate everything he said? And if not, well, how does it influence what he said? That, to me, helps kids to understand things at a more complex level than they often do. I think our whole country would be better off if we were able to handle that level of complexity.
Again, agree 100%. Because, I'm supposed to be the moderator. I'm not answering a question. I'm asking a question. All right. sorry. I had a moment. So, you're all in spaces where you've been able to see in real time ideas and models of transformative learning. I want to start with you on this one, Chris. You share multiple examples of transformative experiences, including your own, in your writing. If we were looking for local or global examples of transformation success, broadly defined, where would you point us, or who would you want us to know?
So I'm going to answer your question, but I'm going to say this first. So there was a moment just now that was an exemplar that I think is so powerful. Right. So here we are. We're in this panel. These brilliant people came to hear us. You heard something. You loved it. You agreed. They laughed. It was magic. And then you were like, whoops. not in a bad way, of course, right? Let me step back and moderate, right? And I think that's the exemplar, right? That even good people who agree with each other or who are impassioned, we are always dealing with this invisible set of rules around how things should be that oftentimes inhibits our ability to be free. And I would argue that freedom is the essence of good exchange. I would argue that if you gave yourself the permission, and this is love, dear sister, I don't know if you guys, y'all get this, I'm not trying to, you know, throw shade at my sister Lavana. But I think when we offer ourselves the freedom to be able to express in that way, what was most powerful in this panel so far to me, and these are brilliant folks, is the moment where you caught yourself, everyone laughed, and for me, for just a millisecond, the room felt lighter. Was it just me? Right? And I think in the lightness of the mood of the room is when we are ready now to receive stuff. And so if somebody asked me, you know, where are the exemplars of really good learning in that way? I'd say, and as I do in the book Ratchetdemic, the places where people laugh the most. People say, you know, what are the most powerful examples of good schools and rap concerts when even a subpar, not especially, but even a subpar lyricist like DJ Khaled can make everybody's hands go up and they stay there, up, down, up, down, up, down. Like, to me, those are where I want to draw my models from. And I don't necessarily have to agree with the nature of the content being delivered. But I have to be free enough to say, listen, the models we got in these here schools, so bad, a DJ Khaled concert can give me a better structure for K-12 education than what we have so far. And if my classrooms felt the euphoria after a Khaled concert, I can have that euphoria with some physics, and kids would learn more physics. And I think that's where the models are, in the places we don't expect. So that's where I tell folks to go.
Thank you so much. Yeah. So Matthew, I wanted you to answer that question as well, because I know that you are in you're in the classroom, and you're also in organizations, and so teaching and also learning. And so what have you seen that kind of encourages you in terms of this transformative space?
Gosh, you know, I think we've seen a lot of recurring words today. I mean, one of those was safe. And that really resonated with me, especially when thinking about organizations. You know, I can step in, and a lot of times, just so everybody knows, you know, when I'm working with an organization, we were talking before this, that since the since March of 2020, one of my three core service areas exploded, and that was strategic planning. And part of it is this realization of, oh, gee, I guess things are uncertain all of the time. And so that became, you know, kind of more and more what I focus on. And so I'm often stepping into rooms full of people from, you know, all different ranks of an organization. And you can tell instantly if people are afraid or if they're excited to be there. It's an immediate feeling, right? This sense of fear coming from a sense of judgment, right? I mean, exactly, Chris, what you're talking about. Am I going to throw an idea out there for the future of this organization and be immediately shot down, right? Or a sense of excitement, where it's the flip of that. Am I going to send out an idea for the future of this organization, for a way that we can take our product or service or whatever it might be, and am I going to be considered in that moment? And so in my mind, you know, I think I answer that question with that word safety, you know, and that, or maybe even better, you know, fear, right? As sort of a feeling that you immediately get stepping into these organizations. And to my surprise, you know, I work across a lot of sectors, public, private, social, a lot of different industries. You might think, you know, the kind of the social sector by default would have that more kind of an embracing, you know, setting, but it's not necessarily the case. It's a mix, and it's not necessarily a theme of bigger organizations, smaller organizations. It comes down to the safety that leader is providing, the culture that the people that are doing the work every day, you know, create as well. So yeah, that's my answer to that.
Thank you so much. And Pedro, leading scholar in top three in terms of education and focusing in on transformation. I would say someone that's been kind of catalytic in this space. And so when people are looking for where do I even start, who should I look at, who should I talk to, who's on your list or what organization?
Well, the good news is there are so many. But I'll give an L.A. example that some of you may know. Jaime Escalante. Jaime Escalante, right here, Garfield High School. You can go to Garfield High School right now and see the mural they dedicated to him. Escalante was an engineer. Got hired by Garfield to teach math. Was assigned to teach remedial math. After a few days, he said, this is a waste of time. These kids should be learning calculus. His department says they can't learn calculus. These are dumb kids, gangbangers. These are the children of waiters and waitresses. He says, no, I can teach them calculus. He starts teaching them calculus. They take the AP exam, pass. So they assume they must have cheated. Require the kids to be retested. They pass again. They do this year after year, so that the size of his class is growing. Finally, they send in researchers to study his methods. Say, okay, what's he doing? And they all come away and they say, all we see is math. Because they understand what he called developing ganas, the desire to learn in kids, right? He got them to believe. He reminded them. He said, you're the descendants of people who built pyramids. Calc is part of who you are, right? Then he took them to aeronautical labs to show them. This is why you need calculus, because he knew he had to show them how it's applied, how it's used. Then he had to challenge them to work hard, come in on Saturday, work through the summer, because it's going to take work, right? I met one of his former students. She's the only Latina engineer at Boeing in Southern California. We were both doing robotics together with kids on a Saturday. She said, everything you hear about Escalante is true. He was there. He pushed us. He challenged us. She said, he used to come to my soccer games. I said, he came to your games? She said, yeah, but not to cheer me on. He would tell me, you stink at soccer. Go back to math. And I'm so glad I did, because that's why I'm an engineer. When he died, big outpouring of former students, many of whom are now professionals, because of one teacher. One teacher for 19 years. He did this. This was at Garfield High, the same school. So if you can do that in East L.A., in one of the poorest neighborhoods in the country, you can do that in schools all over if you have the vision of how to engage those youth. And so the examples are there.
I got to do this because that's such a beautiful story, and I want to help us make it concrete, right? But I want y'all to get this, right? It's about everything we said. So it's love and safety, which seems arbitrary, but they're real, coupled with high expectations. And this is very important for us to say. Oftentimes, those who look to transform education are so hyper-focused on the love and safety that they diminish the academic expectations. And then it becomes a safe space without true learning. So I always say there's a distinction between when you linger with a person or a thing and when you languish, right? Love and safety without high expectation will cause you to languish. Love and safety and high expectations allow you to linger with the content enough to want to soak in and pull in, right, the hope for something more. So if someone asks you, like, what was the, like, that story's so, like, it's so juicy and good and you want to just hold it if it was a person, right? But what he did was he made those young folks know that they were loved. He created an environment where they were safe to make mistakes, to go play soccer and know, like, you're not that good anyway, right? And I will not lower the academic expectations. And when you do those things, and we live in a society where it's like, this is a very rigorous place, you know? So the kids are bored to death, you know, it's rigor and rigor mortis, you know, and then it's like love and safety, but they can't learn anything. And I think it's at the intersection of those things and to bring those worlds together where good learning happens. Sorry, I know it's out of turn, but.
No, I mean, I just think it's magical. I mean, it's like we say all the time that children are the future, but then we try to keep our learning styles and methodologies in the past, and they can't coexist. And the sooner we acknowledge that, the better. I took your advice and just said it, and moving right along. I am a lifelong learner too. All right. I have called on each of you specifically throughout this session, obviously, but this is a whosoever will get us started question. In our initial meeting about today, we talked about the fact that all too often we are focused on the wrong questions in education, most notably achievement versus excitement about learning. From your books, your toolkits, and your personal experiences, what needs to change? And we've got some of that already. If we are really going to spend more time getting people excited about learning and bringing joy into learning. Whosoever will.
You know, I like starting with words, like we've been doing. One of those words that comes to my mind is play, and I think, you know, but I love this kind of breakdown of how can we create the safe and loving space, the rigorous space. What's the Venn diagram there? In my mind, play might be one of the words that's in the middle of that, because play has competition, play has rules. Right, play has a sense of leadership. Play has a sense of playfulness, strangeness, weirdness, right? Wearing whatever damn hat you want to wear, right? And so, you know, for me, I think that's always been very important to me. And I think back to the moment I decided I wanted to be a teacher. I was 6 years old. And my mom had just gotten a job as a substitute teacher. And so she lined up my stuffed animals in my room. And I was going to be her assistant, and she was teaching the stuffed animals. And that, I observed teaching as a form of play in that moment. And that's always influenced me, you know. I have one of my students in the room that Charlie knows, you know, I'm throwing dice in the classroom. I'm asking them to do strange kind of creative prompts in the middle of a session. And I think that, you know, it maybe is my way of trying to find a space between those two things. Yeah, it's about play.
Thank you. Pedro.
So I'll throw another word in. Curiosity. Okay. Curiosity drives learning. And guess what? All kids are naturally curious. If you ever hang out with a 2 or 3 year old, what's the most common question you ever get from them? Why? They want to know, and they're serious. Right? Why is the sky blue? Right? Why do I have to eat my vegetables? Why do I have to take a bath? Right? And they want an answer. And often the answer comes another why. But what that's telling us is if you can feed that love of learning, that interest in learning, and there's good research to show it, kids will become self-motivated learners. And that's what we should be after. Not people who have to be force-fed, right? But kids who want to know why. Think about how different this country would be right now if people didn't just, they could distinguish real news from fake news. They would ask why. Why is this author trying to influence me in this way? Who is that person? What is the evidence? Wow. That curiosity would change the way we look at things. And so rather than teaching kids that there's an answer and it's in the back of the book and there's just one, we should be saying, no, we're going to keep exploring and try to understand and unpack so we can understand why.
Thank you.
So good. Jeez. So play, curiosity, and I should be taking notes in my head. And in both Ratchetdemic and STEM Steam Make Dream, one of the arguments that I make throughout is that we don't get enough space for young people to dream. And I think dreaming is a verb, you know, space for you to be able to learn the content and then take a time out and just play with it in your head, right? What could be? I always ask, so I gave you this, like, what else could we do with this? The activation of the imagination. I always say learning is not memorization. It's the activation of the imagination and a path towards liberation. And the activation of the imagination is the opportunity to be able to see beyond. And when people learn, I'm allowing you to dream, then the question becomes, how do I manifest this dream? And then there are concrete things in real time that can help you to manifest them. So, you know, I would add to that dreaming, you know, radical dreaming.
Yeah. Thank you. Amazing. Truly amazing. Again, I appreciate everything that's been said today, and I'm sure the audience does as well. I have one final question before I ask the audience if they have questions. And again, general question. Is there anything else you want to share with the audience to help them fully appreciate the importance of your work in structuring how our thinking about, again, learning? Anything else? And again, recognize I started off with the lifespan. And recognizing, again, it's like learning is ideally a lifelong activity. And so how can you help us stay in that mode?
You know, for me, I think it's very good that we are focusing on the students, those who are receiving the information. And I'm equally as concerned about the teacher. And I think, you know, there's this powerful quote that's always struck me that says a student's learning conditions are a teacher's working conditions, and you cannot expect a teacher to make a young person feel free and whole and welcome if the teacher themselves feel like they've been robbed of those things. And in Ratchetdemic, the last chapter, I get into these concepts of the rights of the body, which draws from sort of Eastern traditions, but the things that all people deserve as human beings, the right to be here, that I'm not a guest in this school, I'm not a guest in your space, but I have a right to enter the space, the right to feel that I can be angry that you're having me back after a pandemic and you don't care about whether or not, the right to love and be loved, right? The right to see things differently, the right to speak truth to power, right? And then the right to knowledge and high expectations. So for me, it's about, you can't get a teacher to be culturally relevant if that teacher ain't culturally relevant to theyself, fam. You can't skip over the teacher and say, we care about kids. It doesn't make sense. So the work has to be equal parts focusing on creating these conditions for young people by first emphasizing and creating the conditions to allow the teachers to be able to model what we want for the young folks to be able to see and do.
Thank you. Anyone else? Pedro or Matthew?
Sure. I would say this. Education's always about two things. Preparing this generation for life as it is so they can get jobs, so they can have the skills they need to take care of themselves, and preparing that generation to solve the problems of the last generation.
That's huge.
Right? Because the knowledge we have now has got us to where we are now. Right? And if you're not content with the way the world is, you have to hope that the next generation is going to have the imagination, the creativity, to think past where we are to create something better. How do we make sure that learning allows for that? right, allows for that chance to dream, to think through new possibilities, new ways of understanding things, so that we don't just recreate the same mess we're in now. Right? And so I think the challenge we face is to create schools and colleges which not just encourage creativity and dreaming, but problem solving, so that, in fact, it can be a resource for the future. I think that, you know, I was talking to a group of young people recently and said, well, you know, college, why is college important? You can get a job, a good job now if you have enough skills. I said, because education is not simply about getting a job. It's about so much more. The reason why it was made illegal to teach enslaved people to read and write, because slave masters understood it. It was not about a job. It was about power and freedom. Mm-hmm. Right? An enslaved person is hard to control, and that's still true. Right? So we need to make sure that education is used to help people to dream and to think beyond what is right now.
Thank you.
That's a tough one to follow. You know, one of the things I think about the school that I'm teaching in, the Iovine and Young Academy, and what attracted me to it, and there's a few examples of this, is I even think back to when I was in college, you hear about the real world. It's like this kind of mythical creature, and this certainly isn't it, you know. School certainly isn't the real world, right? Like, I don't know. There was always this really bizarre conversation around that. Like, when you get to the real world, you'll do this. In the real world, they do it like that. And I've really enjoyed teaching in a school that feels like the real world, right? And I like framing the classroom as the real world by, you know, really trying to create that bridge between the way that life is outside of the classroom, the way that work might be outside of the classroom, and the subjects and the topics that we discuss, you know. And so I do think a design-driven approach encourages that, because it's very much about people, and it's very much about speaking to people, listening to people, understanding problems that exist, understanding challenges that exist, trying to define those challenges, trying to create prompts and briefs that can set us up to, you know, find our place in tackling said challenge. And so, you know, maybe my thing to leave for the audience is I hope you check out design methodologies. You know, there a lot of them are kind of wrapped up in industry, but they have a lot of interesting application to the classroom as well.
Thank you. So I'm going to open it up to questions from the audience. If they're so we've got one hand up. Please wait until we get two hands, until we get the microphone. And so I guess, yeah, we're asking you to come to the microphone. This is an aerobic session, so very appreciative of that.
Thank you. This is an amazing. So I was a previous elementary educator. I'm now a parent. And I now work in ed advocacy, and it's a nonprofit teaching a free course, How the California Education System Works, so parents can better advocate. But now a lot of what I'm hearing, I think I've heard teacher, I've heard students, and I haven't heard parents or guardians. So what I'd like to hear is one thing I'm seeing, and you've helped give me language for it, is oftentimes the parents I'm working with don't necessarily feel safe. They don't necessarily have a lot of the ability to play, to be curious. And to model that in the home life as well. So just from your experiences, do you have any tips on how to bring this forth in supporting parents so that way they can therefore help their students?
So the reason why I wrote the book STEM, STEAM, Make, Dream is for that purpose. So it specifically revolves around STEM education, but it's for parents to be able to read, to understand that they've been colonized into thinking that they need their child to be a certain way, right? And so I interview like the dude who invented the super soaker, who's now like a multimillionaire, who would argue that the reason why he was able to have that kind of imagination is because his mom would like let him cook with her and talk through science concepts as they cook. So parents oftentimes think that the things that they do every day are separate from helping their child to be an intellectual and academic, when in reality, everything that we do every day is deeply intellectual and academic and thoughtful. And so for parents, I always say, like, don't leave it to them. reimagine what you do with your child every day and think about that. So Leland Melvin is a NASA astronaut and also a former NFL football player. And I'm like, how did that happen? It's like one day my dad wanted to take us on vacation and we didn't have enough money. So he bought this weird camper and then we worked on it together. And as we worked on it together and I was doing the work at hand, I started realizing, wait, this is interesting. And I started asking more questions. And so what I would say to parents is, one, never leave the education of your child to an institution who does not necessarily understand your child. Mm-hmm. And no one understands your child more than you do. And you can teach your child every day through things that you have to do just to survive. I could teach math to you by what time I got to wake up in the morning to make it to the first job, the space I have been sitting in the second job. And if you frame your everyday existence through the lens of how it connects to content, your child's relationship to the content is drastically improved. So that's like one thing I would say. And the second thing I would say is that we have to, and this is hard to say, but we got to say it. Parents have been traumatized themselves by the very school system that they're sending their children to. They feel like they have to send their kids to a place that didn't work for them. So there's trauma going on here. And so in Ratchetdemic, we talk about, like, how do we help folks to heal from the PTSD that is school, like poor teaching and school disorder is a trauma. It's a new PTSD, but it's real. And if you frame that experience like a trauma, their approach to how they articulate their experiences with institutions helps them to concurrently heal and then save their children. And so I would say, like, that kind of language helps parents to just reimagine the significance of their relationship to the schooling enterprise and to the education enterprise. And once they get to healing, healing is the seedbed for agency. Mm-hmm. But as long as you're not healed, you feel disempowered. Is that helpful a little bit?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
I would just very quickly say this. One of my former students, a teacher, when back to school night happens, he always asks, this is how he introduced himself to the parent. He says, you know more about your child than I do. What can you tell me about your child that I should know so I can be a better teacher? Think about that as a parent if someone said that to you. Right? So it's another way of putting what Chris just said.
Hello. My question was how to have vocabulary to make a safe space and not shut people down on accident or even on purpose. Like, sometimes I'm trying to, I have a scene recreation for a school that I'm doing, and someone had an idea, and they wanted a car on set, and I said, you can't have a car on this set that doesn't have an entrance for a car. But I could have worded it better, so, yeah.
You know, a couple of things come to my mind. Again, more in a design education context. Whenever I am trying to demonstrate the creation of something, let's say it's like a visualization of something or anything like that, I actually intentionally, as the teacher, draw poorly. And it was something that I don't know where I got this. I feel like somebody gave me this as advice, and I thought it was really good advice, is if the student in the classroom that's thinking, man, I can't draw, because somebody in third grade told them that apple doesn't look like an apple, like throw that away, right? They'll feel safe because you're being vulnerable in that moment, right? So that's one thing that kind of comes to my mind. Another thing that I like to do is sometimes I have lessons or experiences that aren't planned in the classroom. So, you know, for example, we were talking about synthesis, like how do you synthesize all kinds of research information that you might receive. And I started the class by asking everyone, you know, if you're willing and able, I want you to sit under the table in front of you right now. And then, you know, I was like, and I want you to face north, clap your hands 3 times, whisper something to the person next to you. I kept, like, just making stuff up, basically. And then I said, okay, now go back to your seats. And then all I did, I didn't have this lesson plan at all. I just said, why did we just do that? And there was probably a 30-minute conversation that was really great. And what I knew was going to happen is they were going to be synthesizing what just happened, right? They're going to be kind of recapping, summarizing. So I knew that that was going to happen, but I didn't know the details of how. And in my mind, that resulted in a safe space as well, even if it felt a little awkward. because there wasn't a plan there, right? It was kind of letting them run with their own interpretation of something. So a couple ideas that come to mind.
I love that modeling thing, Matthew. That's good, man. That's some good stuff right there.
Thanks. Yeah.
Hi, first-time questioner, long-time admirer of y'all's work. Okay, let me see how I can get this question out. It's been in my mind as I'm listening to all of the different points, and I am thinking a lot about the, like, college for all charter movement. It's probably a risky question to ask on a college campus with a bunch of college employees. And I also recognize that I'm coming from a space as a white woman with a lot of unearned privilege and generational wealth, and went into a career in education in very much like this college for all, high academic expectations, love, acceptance, safety. And we're hearing from alums, not just from my school system, but seeing other data that, like, while we have done good, and some families are on a different pathway, we're also causing some harm. So those unintentional consequences where students and families are strapped with student debt, maybe didn't finish. And so we're in this, like, rethinking, maybe a redesign process, I don't know yet, about, like, is this college for all, straight out of high school, like, that's the goal? Is that still the right path forward in transformation, not reform? So just curious if you have thoughts on it.
College still works, right? You know, it's important to say, you know, you get higher education. There's endless statistics to support the fact that with that degree, even sometimes though you're saddled with debt, although, you know, the big homie out there in the White House said he's going to cancel some of that joint, and he didn't. But we know that that's a pathway towards a transformation of your lifestyle. But here's the thing. I think that we articulate a very simplistic notion of what the path looks like. Mm. And then we force everyone, like, you just go, you do this, you do that, you do that, you do that, you come out the end, and then that doesn't quite work. So, you know, I'm a firm believer. Like, my thing, like, Ratchetdemic, the theme, all that stuff is about welcoming nimbleness. So I think about my experience. Like, I went to college, I worked security at night, and then I worked in the day. Then I was like, yo, I don't have fresh clothes. So I got a job at the Gap. And some folks like, well, that's an arbitrary notion of you describing your experience. But there was something about that, which was like the nimbleness in the process, right? Like, you can arrange classes the ways that work for you. You can slow it down and get a little gig, a little extra. Young people are being sent to college and career, and nobody's talking about them how to apply for financial aid and get grants. Like, so if you're, it's about showcasing the multiplicity of experiences that the college going pathway is not about. You just go, you take a class, you take out loans, the end. You know, you have to introduce young folks to the multiple ways that they can do it and the multiple stories they can do it. And the fact that their own story may be different, but they got to finish. You know, this is a big thing. Let's not be like, well, some kids didn't go. And I mean, some kids went and they had debt. Yeah, we know that. But also the trajectory of their lives is exponentially increased by function of going. Mm. So it's about mixing it up. You know, I'm also a firm believer, real quick, in like the significance of having folks be able to do stuff. So we're in a society where it says you're going to college. So you just read a bunch of books and then you graduate and then you can't change a tire. Mm. That's not an education, bruh. Mm-hmm. Right. And we've created these sort of like, you're smart, so you just read stuff all day, and now you get a degree. No, I want people to be able to do and think and play. And STEM, STEAM, Make, Dream. The chapter on make is my favorite chapter, because they're like science, technology, and making things, doing things. Like, can you use a saw? And I can use a saw, and still understand complex physics, and that's not menial labor. That's supplementary knowledge. And that should be a part of the narrative around going to college and being educated on all things. So I think it's just expanding out the notion of what it looks like and expanding the definition. But please keep sending them babies to college.
Okay.
You know, it's important.
Yeah, we're not taking it off.
Okay,
the
okay, all right. So you considering taking it off? Like, no.
Trying to avoid harm. Thank you.
Hi, My name is Amalia. I'm a high school English teacher. And within the umbrella of education innovation, I also think about like technology. And I was wondering if you guys had any words of wisdom in regard to the balance and integration of technology within the umbrella of innovation. Because it's something I'm struggling with.
Gosh, well, that's so the program I teach in, it's arts, technology, and the business of innovation. So technology is the big one in the middle. And I think, you know, the thing that I've seen that has worked is seeing technology, at least in the context of our program, and this may or may not translate exactly, but seeing it as a language requirement, but not necessarily as a prescription of now you must go and be an engineer or this must be your career pathway, but it's how can you actually understand how things are built, right? How can you understand the language of this? The other thing that I've seen, too, is starting concepts that might be quick to computer on paper. That's something that I think that we do really well is we teach our students how to draw. I kind of spoke to that a little bit earlier. The end result is not intended to be like a napkin sketch, but we're trying to teach them how to actually communicate, right? And so similarly with technology, it's kind of how can you communicate to somebody that does decide this is what I really want to do without kind of going down this path that I feel like we do see quite a lot of assuming everyone must become engineers or, you know, this must be the career pathway, right? Really prescribing that.
Thank you.
And tech got to be not just about consumption, but also about production and what you make. And I'll just say this real quick, an anecdote that's really important to me. I was working with a school once, and every year they'd buy all these new computers because the old ones are outdated. And I was like, okay, this is phenomenal that you guys are keeping up to date. You know, what'd you do with all the old ones? And they're like, well, we either threw them out or they're in the basement. That was fascinating to me, right? Because what you want to be able to do, technology, like get these kids some screwdrivers and take them apart and find out how they work. Like the technology tool is not because it's not supposed to be just the pathway towards learning. Right, you have to be able to understand the inner workings of the devices and the tools that we use, and it's also for us to keep up with the use of these things. Right, like, you know what COVID and pandemic taught us, this ain't going nowhere. And how do we reimagine schools to be able to incorporate this notion of hybridity, digital spaces, so it's equal parts the use of the tools, but also the understandings of how they work. I want kids to break stuff, especially if you're gonna throw it away anyway. So it's not just consumption, it's consumption, production, and then understanding like the technical aspects of these devices. Right.
Mm-hmm. Hi there. I'm a first year teacher. I teach 7th grade English and history. And everything you guys have been saying, I'm just thinking like, oh, that's everything I want to do in my classroom. And I've been trying to do things like that where we're having conversations about identity and social justice within the context of history and the books we read and stuff. But in the past 2 weeks, even, I've found it very difficult that my kids are still expected to do a very traditional standardized state testing. I feel like they're prepared, but at the same time, it's very constrictive to their ability to think. And it's not asking them those why questions. It's the expectation that they have to write a 7-sentence paragraph, or they have to know which sentence fits better here. So I just, for a first year teacher, like what kind of advice would you give in regards to being the teacher that we want to be for the rest of our lives versus meeting the standards that districts, schools, states, all these kinds of stuff require of us, because that's not something they teach you in credential school.
I'll give it a shot. So I would say that it's important to know what the kids will need to know, mm-hmm, so that they can perform on these assessments that they're going to take, since we can't change that for right now. But once you understand that, then you have the creativity for how you're going to get them there, right? And you should, because ultimately what they really need is to know how to write well, how to problem solve. I mean, imagine if kids during the pandemic were just reading at home, how much better off they would have been, right? Because once you have that ability to read, you can actually learn so much on your own. So it is, I would say, don't let the standards limit you, right? Use that as the kind of guide from which to improvise. Mm-hmm. But make sure they get what they need, yeah. right? So that they are, in fact, prepared, but don't limit it to that.
Yeah, thank you very much.
So I am I'm not going to say controlled, but instructed to say, we want to thank you again for being here and to recognize that the books and the authors are going to be right upstairs, and there will be a chance to for you to ask additional questions. The rest of us just won't be able to hear some of the answers. So again, thank you for this marvelous panel. Thank you.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcast.usc.edu.